Let me tell you about Rembrandt's The Night Watch. It is not what you think it is. I've uncovered the truth behind this great masterpiece. It all comes from a discovery that I made, Little Cupid by Antonio Allegri di Correggio, which was part of a set of six great mythological works. A Venus Satyr Cupid, A School of Love, an Io painting, a Ganymede painting, a Leda and the Swan, and a Danai painting. These six paintings are the true mystery behind Rembrandt's The Night Watch. Rembrandt embedded these works within his inner reimagination, and that was the genius code that all the great masters did. And I'm going to share this with you and explain this real truth behind The Night Watch. My name is Daniel Dawson Gordon. This is my discovery. Enjoy. And we'll start off with the central figures in the picture. This lieutenant and this other figure with the feathers in his hat. Now what we start with here is the School of Love. That central figure we have represents the Venus. So as we look at his neck ruff, if we turn it to the side, that is the Venus's wing. We again look at his broad face, it's just like the Venus. If we look at Venus's feet, the left foot is pushed forward and the right foot is slightly back. That is the same as this lieutenant's shawl across him. I believe this would have been the blanket covering Venus's genitalia. The figure next to the lieutenant is on side profile, just like Little Cupid. But if you look at the feathers on this figure's hat, so if we turn Cupid's wings and overlay them, they are a direct match for the positioning of Cupid's wings. So here we can see the color match of Cupid's wings, the blue, yellow and gold, with the beads around this figure's hat, around his chest, and also down to his spear, you see the same colors. So if you look at his feet again, just as Little Cupid's feet, his right foot is pushing forward and his left foot is slightly back and inclined. So here is a Venus, Cupid and Mercury, as in the School of Love. So then we think, where is Mercury? Exactly in the position he should be in. He's looking in the same angle we have Mercury. And this fellow is looking down, just like Mercury would be looking down at his son Cupid. If we look down at his feet, we can see that the positions of the feet, the right foot coming forward and the left foot slightly back, inclined, is exactly the same as Correggio's Mercury. The Mercury also has his hat on and this guy has his helmet on, is very much representing the Mercury. So we'll go across the painting now and we will see the Danai painting. And this fella with the drum has his head inclined and is in the same mood and look and view as Danai. We have the Psyche with his outstretched arm, just like this figure in this right side of the painting. We have the two little Cupids, which are these two figures, one side looking, one looking across. He's even holding his gun, just like this little Cupid is holding his arrow. I can even see familiar detail in the drum, which matches the bed of Danai. This golden cloud-shaped object represents the cloud in Danai. The golden shower of coins that land in the lap of Danai are represented here in this figure's arm. We can even see above this area, very high up in the picture, is a representation of a window. It's funny how that is in the area of Danai. So again, we'll look through. Here is the Danai matching this guy on the right side of the picture. We have the Psyche, we have the two Cupids here. The Danai's feet are still in the position. The right foot is further up higher than the left foot. Now we bounce back to the central part of the painting again, and we're looking at the center, but slightly above the first figures that we worked with, which was the School of Love. This figure is portrayed from Zeus in the Io painting, who is a cloud. So his face is distorted, not because of the perspective, because you have figures further back in the painting which have great enhanced detail and are not blurry. This guy is blurry because he is the cloud. And below his face is this other figure who represents Io. And Io has a hand outstretched, and this chap has his hand outstretched. But then as we compare these two figures with the Io painting, we look down. And what does Io have? She is embraced by the cloud, by hand. But then as we look down the composition, and there is the hand. And that hand is a match for the hand within the cloud in Correggio's Io. The sheet around this figure in the correct position is clearly of the sheet around Io. But what other two key features do we have in Correggio's Io painting? We have the large pot, we have the deer. So if we go down this figure, if you look at his bottom right boot, it's different from his left boot, and it's rolled back, and it has a rim rolled back, just like the Io's pot. Where is the deer drinking the water? Now, if we look into this figure's embroidery in his dress, close up, there is the deer. If you turn him around, if you see the deer is drinking from a stream, he's drinking water. So here we have the school of love, the Danai, and now we have discovered the Io. Let's go to Io's counterpart, the Ganymede. If we go back to the right side of the painting, next to Danai, we can see there is a dog below, just as the Ganymede was. If we see this figure here with the big feathers on his hat, looking directly at us like Ganymede was, with his head inclined on an angle, this is Ganymede. He's holding this pole, and this pole, with another pole crossing through, represents a fork. And if you look at the dog in the Ganymede, to the left of it is a tree that is forked. Now if you look above the dog in the Rembrandt Night Watch, the pole represents the tree and it forks off just like the tree. So where is the eagle? To the right of what represents Ganymede, just in the back there, the eagle, which is in the painting of the Night Watch, is most likely a helmet with a stud, but that is the eye of the eagle just there in the background. The dog, the Ganymede, the eagle, and the tree. Rembrandt was infatuated with the Leda painting, and the Leda painting is of course in the Night Watch. If we go to the left side, and what we will have to do here is add the original figures back to the painting, and we use the figures in the early copy from the National Gallery to show you where they were and how they would have looked. So if we start off with Leda, this figure represents Leda. Leda has directly below her a swan. But this figure, you look down and you think, where is the swan? So here we have a large rifle, and the swan has this large, long neck. So what I did was I looked at this rifle to find the swan. So I follow the rifle's barrel down to the shaft, and then there it is. This lady here has maybe a chicken, but this bird represents the swan. So this figure has the swan below here. But if you look at the body of the swan in Leda the Swan above, who is above the swan? The Leda's maid. And in the same position above this swan, we have this figure that matches the maid. But she has a gold sheet there that she has in front of her. And this gold sheet may be why that this figure has been influenced to be painted in gold, in gold clothing. If you look at the figure in the Night Watch that represents the Leda, his feet also are outstretched in the same positions as Leda's feet positions. To the left of Leda, the Psyche, which is holding a pointy harp, and this figure in the Night Watch has the same look to Psyche and is holding a pointy axe, just like the Leda Psyche figure. If we go to the right of Leda, and we have the maid that holds the dress, I attribute this figure here, looking to the right, just like the Correggio picture. Leda in the Correggio Leda is depicted three times. So this
version of leader looking up is this chap here looking up, and he has his arm outstretched as leader has a arm outstretched. Where is the swan flying off? You cannot mistake it. If you look at his neck ruff and collar, that represents the wings. And if you look at the feet of the swan, they are the tassels. And so where would slightly below this swan would be the other swan in the composition? Well, I believe that if we look back at the Zeus, this neck collar is representing the other swan. So in Correggio's Leader and the Swan, there is three representations of the swan. And in Rembrandt's Night Watch, we have discovered the three representations of the swan. The main central swan at the bottom of the barrel of the gun, the flight of the swan on the neck ruff of the leader, the swan that's doing the courting just below the cloudy face on the neck ruff. So we now have two figures left. Where would they have been? Well, if you didn't know that the painting was cut down, you'd never find them. But if we look at these two figures here, they represent these two little cherubs. One looking forward, just like this little cherub is, and one looking side profile with his arm outstretched to the right. This wide-faced person is leader, being courted by the swan. Is depicted as this character here with the helmet on and the tassels. And if we look at his positioning, he's slightly above the IO neck ruff of the swan. And if we look in the Night Watch overall, we will see the three leaders in a row. The leader saying goodbye to the swan, the leader to the right being courted by the swan, and the leader below here with the gun is the act of the swan. So if we look central to the picture of the Night Watch, we can see the two chief paintings of Correggio's mythological works. We've already worked out that right in the center, this is the School of Love's Venus. So where would the Venus Satyr Cupid's Venus be in this picture? Directly above in its correct position, because that was, I believe, and is recorded as one of his greatest mythological works. So if we have the Venus, where is the satyr? Slightly above, but to the right, we have the satyr here with his arms out, and instead of holding the blanket, he's holding a pole. What is to the right of the satyr? And that is the forked tree. Now if we look at this militant figure, which depicts my satyr, he has the side profile, but is revealing both eyes. To the right, where is the forked tree? Well, here it is. We have the spears are cross-referencing across each other. What has enabled us to reveal the truth lost to art history? And it all comes down to my painting of Cupid by Correggio. So where is Cupid in this painting? If we look to the bottom left, here he is. You have his left leg outstretched backwards, rising up, with his right foot pushing forward. His face side profiled. So here is the Cupid. We've used the forked tree, we've used the satyr, we've used the Venus, but what about the lion's rug? Well, just next to the Cupid, in the extra part of the painting that was cut away, that we've replaced, this cheeky little, peculiar little face here allocates the lion's head in the rug. Scholars have always said, why is this little boy in this picture? And I've worked out who the little boy is. The little boy is Cupid. I've worked out who the figures are. They're the mythological works by Correggio. And why Rembrandt's work was so famous is because he used the best works in history to influence his works. So we have completed the six mythologicals and we have seven figures remaining. But who could these figures be? Well, I've worked it out. So there's a picture now lost to history. We can see through engravings, this is Correggio's muleteers with a donkey and these two figures. So as we look at figures we haven't allocated yet, we have these two gentlemen. Let's look at these two male figures in the muleteers. See how they match with these two gentlemen. Now if we look, one of them has a similar hat and the other guy is looking in an exact same profile and position as the chap in the muleteers. They're quite a great match. There's even the man with this hat on the right, his ear is showing, and we can see this guy's ear and beard. This is that character. So if we've got these two gentlemen in there, where is the donkey, the mule? If you see this chap here, his leg is outstretched like a mule or donkey strolling along. The helmet has the floral details as above the donkey, points as if the two points of two ears of the donkey, but below the donkey's face on the muzzle has this cross-hatched design. And if we go down, we can see this cross-hatching design on this headless figure. If we look at the foot, the way the boot and shoe has been designed, it looks quite similar hoof-like in its representation. This leaf detail on the top of the helmet, which would have been shows as leaves, is quite like the leaves in the background of the muleteers on the tree. So the two figures clearly show the muleteers. We have the mule himself.
And we are now left with four figures remaining.
And it's always been said that this figure in the background is Rembrandt himself. I believe this little figure in the background here is Rembrandt's daughter. This other figure in the background is Rembrandt's son.
And here on the far left, we have Rembrandt's other son. As with each one of these members of Rembrandt's family, including himself, they are smallest, obscure, little depictions of faces, different from everybody else in the painting. So my conclusion is, Rembrandt is playing the game, same as every other great master, depicting his favourite Correggio work within his own. He's incorporated himself and his family, all for you to see and enjoy in the Night Watch.